All right. Okay, let's get started. People can join when they join. So I am going, okay, it's recording. All right, hello everyone, and thank you for joining our special webinar today. My name is Sumaira. I am a patient living with seronegative neuromyelitis optica. This is a rare autoimmune disease. I got diagnosed in 2014 after quite suddenly losing my vision. 1 month after I got sick, I decided to launch the Sumaira Foundation with hopes of educating the world about NMO and now MOG, fundraise to support research, build communities of support for patients and their caregivers, and advocate for this wonderful community. So thank you for joining today's webinar. It's the simplifying the healthcare system, something we know is very complex. Just wanted to share that, you know, rare diseases need more advocacy, period, whether it's NMO, MOG, or anything else. We all just need to be, you know, rolling up our sleeves and doing the work because there's so much work to do. So we're very excited to partner with VMLY&R Health for an exclusive webinar to uncover the different stakeholders who have influence in the healthcare system and how patients like you and I can engage with them. This is live, as I said, and it is being recorded, so it will be available for replay on TSF's YouTube and Facebook video libraries. There will be a dedicated time later in the workshop to ask our wonderful experts some questions. Please keep in mind that this is a very broad discussion about healthcare, the healthcare system. Of course, it varies from geography to geography, but we wanted to start with the basics and understand who are the different stakeholders in the healthcare system and how we can communicate with them to advocate for our diseases. So without further ado, I would like to turn it over to our special guest, Dr. Ankita Batla. She is she's in charge of medical strategy and patient partnerships at VMLY&R Health, and Caitlin Rich, who is a research associate, also oversees consulting and patient partnerships at VMLY. Oh, that I'm never going to get that, guys. VMLY&R Health. Both are based in London. I'm actually very excited to be meeting them next week. Without further ado, I will turn it over to the both of you. Thanks for being here. Thanks for doing this for us.
Great. Thank you, Sumaira. And what an honor to be here and talking to all the wonderful people on this call. I hope the information that we share is useful, is practical, is something you can take up and bring it into your patient engagement lives. So what we would like to do is kind of start with a quick video, because we thought it's in most geographies, it is nap time. People have had lunch, are feeling a bit sleepy. Let's start with a video and just startle our senses. But the video is very special because it tells the story of the first patient advocacy movement. And it also talks about the power of patient ambassadors, of what they can really achieve. So we'll just watch a quick video and then we'll move on to our wonderful information about all the stakeholders in the healthcare system and how patient ambassadors have this opportunity to really engage and make a difference across all those stakeholders.
We are in the middle of a plague. 40 million infected people is a plague.
AIDS is now the leading cause of death.
Demonstrators blocked access to buildings.
A coalition of gay groups came to shut down the FDA.
This government has the resources to deal with the AIDS epidemic, and they won't do it unless we force them.
We want everybody to join us. We are trying to arouse to anger and action.
Until we get our acts together, we are as good as dead.
I started to look for treatments to help save our life.
I wish they'd shut their mouths and get their mentality out of their crotches.
There was nothing coming out of our government's efforts.
But no, they march in the streets. They defy you.
I decided to become a full-time AIDS activist.
We all had to become scientists to some degree.
We can take a drug, your test tube, to the market in under 2 years. This total reluctance on your part is going to get you nowhere. It'll end up killing us.
The death rate just kept on climbing.
It became very clear that you weren't going to mess with these people.
I am going to fight them. My patients are going to fight them. And you're not damn welcome.
We need our government to save our lives.
This isn't going to be cured for years and years and years. I'm going to die from this.
Someday, there will be a people alive on this earth who will hear the story that once there was a terrible disease and that a brave group of people stood up and fought and in some cases died so that others might live and be free.
Great. So what you just saw on the screen was one of the earliest documented patient advocacy group movements. I just saw a chat message. Every time I see that video, it gives me goosebumps because it is a story that has to be told to all patient advocates. This is a story about AIDS and AIDS activism, something that set the tone for what patient advocacy groups and what individual patients can actually achieve for a disease, for people suffering from the condition, and how they can change how therapy is administered. So let me tell you the story of Mike Petrilis. Mike Petrilis, in the 1980s, was diagnosed with HIV. In those days, HIV was a disease of white gay men. Nobody wanted to talk about them. People were dying every day. It had epidemic proportions. Nobody wanted to talk about it. So there were patient groups. And these patient groups did one thing. They came together after a diagnosis. Patients came to this group and they were offered consolation. They were offered support with how to manage your finances because you'll be gone in a couple of years. And they were provided guidance on how to write their will. Mike Petrilis, sitting there, opposed the system. He said, I won't write a will. I want a cure. There was pent up anger in these young men of being neglected by healthcare practitioners, by society, by government, and in many cases, their own families. What they did instead, what you saw in the video, was a lot of activism. But was it activism for the sake of activism? Was it just slogans? No, they were an educated lot. They took upon themselves to find a cure for their problem. So they set up researching how drugs are administered, how drugs are actually developed for a condition. And they knocked at the doors of pharmaceutical companies. They went to the Center of Disease Control in the US. They went to the FDA. Nobody was ready to speak to them. For all the obvious reasons, patients are lay people. How can they talk science? How can they talk cure? How can they take things in their own hands? And that is something that many patient ambassadors face in their daily lives. People don't want to listen to the lived experience, and you have to actually make a point of what you are there for and what you can achieve. So in summary, what they achieved was very special. They, for the first time, made the FDA talk to patients. They, for the first time, established that process that nowadays is known as expanded access, where even if a drug is not completely proved to be safe and effective, is offered to patients who are in terminal stages. It was through them that the design of clinical trials was changed. They said, you don't need to do trials for long periods of time. You can actually do clinical trials with a small subset of patients very quickly, arrive at results, and move on from there. So they changed how pharmaceutical companies do research. They knocked at their doors. They ensured that the drugs were available for patients at reasonable prices. They changed the way AIDS patients got one, respect, second, treatment, and third, acknowledgement as people who are experts in their disease. So that was the story we wanted to start with, because that really leads on to our topic for today. So our topic for today really is about patient advocates. And Caitlin, would you move on to the next one? Yes. Patient advocates. And why should patients really engage? Why do they, I mean, there can be many patients, as you would see. I am a patient. You are a patient. We all have different conditions, and all that needs is accessing the healthcare system, you know, getting some treatment, getting some medication. Why do we need to engage more? Because we have an opportunity to shape health outcomes, like we saw in the documentary just now. We can design the health services. We can improve our experiences as we access healthcare in hospitals, in health centers. And not just that, we can drive research, really give physicians and other academic researchers a list of priorities. What is the patient priority for research? What does the patient want? And that should be the agenda of research rather than what the physician or the researcher wants to really do research on. So the, here is a quote from a patient and public voice partner here in the NHS. They say, becoming an expert has helped build my confidence and given me a taste of what the voice of patients can actually be. Now, as we go ahead, one warning, don't be scared of the slides. They have a lot of text on them. We'll give you an overview. The lot of text is there so that we can then share these slides with you and you can really sit back with a cup of coffee and go through all the details that are there. So yeah, so don't be scared of all that text. Now, patient engagement is just important for patients because, you know, in any relationship, it has to be both parties. Are the other parties interested in engaging with you? Are policymakers, pharmaceutical companies, payers, are they interested? Yes, they are, for various reasons. Of late, they have realized that patient engagement improves their own processes. They are able to arrive at outcomes faster. They are able to develop better drugs. They are able to make cost-effective solutions to problems that patients face. And most importantly, it has almost become a legal requirement for any drug to be approved or any research ethics to be approved. It has to show how they have engaged with patients. So these are some of the reasons why patient engagement has become so important these days. But for patient ambassadors, let's look at who exists in their health in ecosystem. Whom do patient ambassadors can contact, can engage with, can influence? So you have healthcare professionals, you have academics. Now, when I say healthcare professionals, it is of course your doctor that you might see for a problem, but it also includes other people, the pharmacists, the nurses, anybody and everybody who's involved in delivering care. The academics who are at universities and doing vital research, trying to understand what will be available to patients now and in the future. Of course, there is the pharmaceutical industry, the drug manufacturers. For them, patient ambassadors are an important asset, and for patient ambassadors also, engaging with drug developers is a very important part of how medicines are being developed these days. Then there are payers. Now, payers are people who make decisions on whether a drug would be really available in the market in your country. So they are like the budget holders. They decide the drug might be safe, might be effective, but will I make it available to the patients in my country? And then there are the policymakers who make laws around how a disease should be treated, which diseases should be prioritized, and the patient advocacy groups that I'm sure you're very familiar with. And we are going to talk about engaging with all of these healthcare and related stakeholders and what exactly, how you play a role. And we'll also share an example of how this is being done elsewhere. So let's start with academics, I think, engagement with academic and healthcare professionals. So starting with the first section, we would be, let's talk about academic researchers. So these are medical academics who carry out research in, you know, big hospitals. And they specialize in very specific components of the disease. So if they are, for example, doing research on NMO, they would be looking for very specific subtopics. For example, they would be looking for biomarkers, or they might be looking at relapse rate or quality of life. So they have a chosen topic on which they do research, and they often work with the physician who really meets you on every appointment. So they work as a team to do research and improve the care, improve treatments, improve pathways. In terms of how do they engage with patient groups or patients themselves, they recruit patients into clinical trials because they want to work to improve the care of patients. They want to work to improve new medications that might become available for patients. And then they also want to understand how a disease really affects the life of the patient, because sometimes that is something that the academic or the researcher or the physician might not be really aware of really what happens in the homes of patients. If we move on to the next one, Caitlin. In terms of healthcare professionals, I'm sure all of you love your doctors. You go and meet them regularly. You have your review appointments, but you also get the medications from the pharmacists. You see the nurses. And these are, of course, the professionals who provide, who are in the front line and provide care to patients. I don't need to tell you a lot about what they do, but one thing you should need to remember is healthcare professionals should ideally be working with you to ensure that the decisions you make in the clinic with them are decisions that are informed decisions, and you make it jointly rather than the healthcare practitioner telling you this needs to be done. So let's move on, Caitlin. Let's show some examples of how this is being done. So some of the ways academics and HCPs engage is, of course, we talked about partnering in research, conducting clinical trials, understanding how patients feel through research into their lives, into services, et cetera. There's something called patient and public involvement activities. This is a term, the term PPIE is often used in the UK, but in every country, there's a parallel to this. So every hospital, every healthcare system has to have a way of engaging with patients and the lay public. And then you can work with your local healthcare groups. And finally, you must be aware of some academic bodies of experts. For example, your ophthalmologist might be a member of, if you're living in Italy, he might be a member of Italian Society of Ophthalmologists. So this is a professional body where experts come together, plan how treatment should be given. They define the guidelines, they publish papers, they conduct conferences. So these professional groups actually have patient working groups. They want to be as close to patients as possible and ensure that all their opinions, thoughts, experiences are taken into account while defining how the treatment should be delivered. So let's show some examples. Let's talk about partnering in research. So the types of research can be a whole lot than just clinical trial. Of course, a clinical trial is a process. It's a research process where you arrive at a treatment. But apart from that, there are things like focus group discussions and advisory boards where they work with patients and patient advocacy groups to define what the clinical trial design should be. It could be also patients reviewing the research which is being done by these academic institutes. Is it fit for purpose? So there are various ways in which academics and healthcare practitioners partner in research with patients. Here's a simple example of a research conducted by London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. They wanted to understand, and this whole project was called Depth, Dialogue, Evidence, Participation, and Transformation for Health. What they wanted to do was understand a patient of sickle cell disease, that's a blood disorder, And it starts in childhood, and often patients' needs change as they transition into adolescence and teenagers and adults eventually. So they wanted to understand how this transition from childhood to adulthood happens. What do patients experience? How can we improve the life of children who go through this transition process? So they ran this multidisciplinary participatory event, which involved clinicians, researchers, but mostly patients and parents and carers. And based on this research, they were able to develop a best practice document on how the transition of patients of sickle cell disease can happen from childhood to adulthood. So that was one example. And, you know, if you go to the line that is at the bottom, because it's so important, that 80% of the expense involved in gathering evidence and research could be really avoided by identification and proper handling of patient needs and research. It is this basic fact that drives all our health ecosystem players to really seek out and partner with patients. Moving on to the next one, we have an example from UCL School of Ophthalmology. Now, this was, like I said, a typical public patient engagement activity for two very rare disorders, aniridia and Fuchs disease. And what they did was they invited patients to come in to the center, sit down with the researchers, and the researchers made a presentation to them about what is the research they are doing and how they are planning to develop new treatments. Patients had the opportunity to comment on these research. They explained to the physicians what they think the research topics should be, what is important to them. And these categories and subcategories of topics really helped researchers navigate their research plans for the coming few years. Because unless you do that, research often becomes a very academic thing to do, which is limited to the hospital or to the clinical labs. If you don't bring in the human context in, it is just research for research's sake. So this whole event was designed to put the patient needs and patient priorities at the heart of research. And in these centers, another thing that I would like to point out is patients are often involved in teaching and assessment and curriculum design. They can help in recruitment of students and staff. So they can review research and contribute to research. So your tertiary care academic hospitals are a good place to find out what is being done about NMSOD there, and you might want to get engaged in their PPIE activities. The next one is around working with local health practices. And you know, your normal community practitioner, family doctor, or general practitioner, like we say in the UK, all of those are mandated to have some or the other form of patient group, because they have to serve a community. And all decisions that they take about how large the building should be, how many beds there should be, how big the waiting room should be, what facilities should be there in the waiting room, all of these should be done in consultation with patients. So explore with your local health practices. I'm sure you'll be able to find how you can contribute to their decisions about, you know, buying, designing the services in the groups, in the hospital. And as a result of that, the people who are involved in managing these clinics and hospitals have to actually declare, and sometimes they really take pride in declaring how they have worked with patients, taken their opinions on various aspects of running that clinic or healthcare group. This is just from a UK community hospital where the patient group, which was regularly meeting, made a huge number of suggestions based on a survey of how they could improve quality. And all of that was implemented. There were simple things like, you know, having the opportunity to have appointments on a Saturday, because that's when most patients are off work and that's the time they have to attend a clinic. Having a better telephone appointment system or having an electronic prescription service. So these are things, as you would imagine, related to patient convenience and patient experience recipients of a health service. And unless patients speak up, it's very difficult for hospitals and health systems to really realize what are the things that we need to prioritize or change, or the changes that we have made, do they really help the patient? So find out from your local health practices, are there things that you could be involved in? So that was around your local health practices. We spoke about, you know, your tertiary care hospitals. We talked about your local health practices. Now let's talk about the professional medical organizations. Now this is really interesting, because all specialists in a condition would be a part of that body. And this could be a national body, for example, like I said, the Italian Society of Ophthalmology, or it might be the European Society of Ophthalmology. But what they have is working groups of patients, and they provide input into a variety of things. Now, professional medical groups, patient committees are obviously, if you go on their websites, they would give details on how to join that patient committee, or you might just want to call them up. This is an example from the European Society of Medical Oncology Working Group. They have a huge patient group which contributes, works very closely with the ESMO physician group. So they provide information, they share experiences, and like we said before, they always put the priority of the patient into the agenda of what doctors are planning to do. And of course, they help because they are sitting at such a high level, engaging with the physicians. They do understand which are the other patient groups. They build a platform where every patient group can come and interact. They also organize their individual meetings where lay patients can attend and understand more about diseases, or probably want to find out what is it that they want to be a top priority in their care, and they take it up with the physicians. So this was all about the healthcare practitioners and academicians and how you can interact with them and really make a change in way drugs are being developed, a way in which services are being designed, how decisions about your care are being taken. So it's almost up to us to fill the next feedback form that we come across from a hospital or our GP surgery, look at which patient groups that they have, go and engage with them, and ensure that every patient of NMSOD that walks into that hospital or clinic is provided optimum care. So the responsibility is to a great extent on patient ambassadors to be proactive. So with that, I think Caitlin, you'll be talking to us about the next section.
Yes, I'll just unmute myself, my turn. Thanks, Ankita. So the next stakeholder we're going to talk about is what we've called industry. And what we mean by that in a healthcare setting is the pharmaceutical industry. So these are the people who make drugs. They make products or tests that are used to treat or test people for or provide symptoms for a disease such as NMO or MOG-D. So some that you might have heard of because of the COVID-19 vaccinations, and they were covered in the news, are Pfizer or AstraZeneca, for example. And some that provide therapies for NMO include Alexion or Horizon Therapeutics or Genentech. So you might have heard of a few of these before, but essentially what they are doing is making a product that they want to sell for their business. So like when you're making any product to sell, you have to think about who the customer is and what they need. Brian, can you go on mute? There's a bit of background noise. Yeah, thank you. Sorry about that. So if you're selling a bottle of Coca-Cola, for example, you need to understand exactly what the customer wants. And for the pharmaceutical industry, the person who is using their product is patients. So they need to understand what patient needs are. Then, as mentioned before, they need patients to test their drugs out to make sure that they're safe and effective. So that's what clinical trials are. They need help recruiting people to clinical trials, because patient groups, a lot of them know all the patients that will be able to take part. And they also do provide some funding and grants for example, awareness campaigns, educational activities, or research that's conducted by groups with, you know, the aim to improve lives, but also to help sell their products. So what are ways that you as patient ambassadors can engage with industry? So one is informing clinical trial design, which we've discussed a few times, informing product strategy, and collaborating with them on advocacy efforts. So just before I dive into each of these, I just wanted to show you a busy diagram. So this is the how and when of patient engagement and drug development. So if you just look at those blue arrows in the middle, that shows the process of developing a drug. So at first we have drug development. So the pharmaceutical company have to decide, what are our research priorities? What are we looking for? And for that, they really need patients, because patients are the only people who understand the disease well and know what the needs are for people who live with it. Then they'll design research and planning. And as we've mentioned before, this is designing clinical trials. Then they'll conduct the research and operations. So they will conduct their clinical trials and they'll do research comparing it to, for example, other treatments that are out there to prove that theirs is better in a way. And also do research about, you know, what's the cost effectiveness of this? What's the impact on quality of life? What's the impact on people's health? And then once they get to that stage and they have a drug that they know has worked and been tested and approved, the next bit is almost like marketing it. So again, you wouldn't market it quite in the same way that you would Coca-Cola or Pepsi or any other brand of drink, but you do have to, someone has to pay for it, okay? And we'll get a little bit about how it's decided which drugs are paid for later. But in that marketing stage, it's also really important that patients are involved to say, you know, this drug is life-changing for me. This is how it affects my life. This is how it affects my health. So patients are really key at each stage here. And just to note, this diagram has been taken from a group called UParty. And what they do is a dedicated training. See all these little black lines coming off? That's where patients can get involved. And what UParty do is train patients into how to get involved at each of these stages. And there'll be a link when we share the slides as well, so you can take a little look at that as well if it's something you're interested in. So the first one, informing clinical trial design, we discussed this a few times, and of course it will include academics and doctors as we discussed previously. But this example here we've got is, so it was a group of patients who had treatment-resistant depression. And when you do a clinical trial, you have to somehow measure the success of your product. And the way that you measure the success is using a particular factor. So for example, you could measure it by just saying, how much anxiety do people think they have after they've taken a product? Or how much sleep deprivation do they have? Does it improve how many days they manage to get out of bed and go to work? So what patients are helpful for at this stage is saying, actually, what really matters to me the most out of all those things that you should measure is the amount of sleep that I get. So, and that might not be correct. I've just given that as an example, but it's really about defining what's actually important to the people who live with this, because that is really the key thing to say, yes, this was effective and helped people improve their lives. The next one is, it's a little bit similar, but informs the product strategy. So that's sort of at the next stage when you have a product. How do we actually sort of sell this in a way and actually use it to help people? So this example was a patient forum. So lots of patients from several different patient advocacy groups for a disease called spinal muscular atrophy. I think I got that right. So they brought people together to discuss what are the key unmet needs for adults with SMA. And they use this to kind of define how their product would meet these key unmet needs. So it's, what do patients need? And then how does my product help? Okay. So that's the product strategy. And then there's also a piece around there as well about how they're going to inform patients of that. And that's really important because for patients to review, to make sure that it's understandable to people who aren't medical professionals. And then the next one is collaborating on advocacy efforts. So as you all know, patient groups do a lot of advocacy, whether it's, you know, lobbying, campaigning, raising awareness. And when a pharmaceutical company has or is developing a product in a certain disease area, they might help patient advocacy groups raise awareness, either by working on something together or by just funding, giving a grant to a patient advocacy group to raise awareness. So an example that we have here is a patient charter that was initiated by the pharmaceutical company AstraZeneca. And they worked with a multi-stakeholder group, including patient groups, to develop a patient charter, which sort of outlined, first of all, the needs of people with severe asthma, but also steps that people could take to overcome it. So at this stage, they hadn't actually done any of those actions to overcome it, but they wrote that out, an action plan for how they could improve the lives of people with severe asthma care. So that was really a collaborative effort between AstraZeneca, the pharmaceutical company, academics and patients, and also medical professionals as well. And some pharmaceutical companies will take a step further back than that, and they will just sponsor or give a grant to a patient group to do their own activity. So that's the pharmaceutical industry. And the next group we're going to look at are policymakers. So policymakers is a really broad term that encompasses any individual that's responsible at any level for formulating or amending policy, regulations, guidelines that are adopted by businesses or even healthcare systems. So for example, this could be ministers, or maybe they call them senators in the US, advisors, civil servants, members of parliament, Congress, government, those kind of people at both a local and national and regional level. So they also need to listen to patients to inform their decision making, and they will as well fund activities that meet their own political goals. So I'll just run through a few examples of this. So first of all, advocacy work and policy engagement. So an example of this was this wonderful mum called Charlotte had a son called Billy who had severe epilepsy, and medicinal cannabis was prohibited as a treatment for severe epilepsy, but it would be something that would has been proven to really help. So what she did is she organised a really high profile media campaign to get the attention of policymakers to change that legislation and make medicinal cannabis legal to treat her son and others like him. So because this was such a high profile campaign, it caught attention. They looked into this subject more, they listened to the patient voice. And of course, when you have a high profile campaign, it's in policymakers' interest to do what is popular for people because they usually need to be voted in. So by creating a stir and taking this attention, they actually managed to change the legislation of medicinal cannabis as a therapy for both severe epilepsy for Billy and for other similar patients. Then the other thing, again, similar to the pharmaceutical companies in a way, they can, policymakers can fund patient activities that are aligned with their goals. So an example of this was in the UK, so the NHS, which is the health service, in the NHS community in Nottingham, they wanted to become the first city in the UK to declare itself zero tolerance for female genital mutation. So what they did there is they actually provided a grant to a charity called the Majatu Foundation. And they used that grant to create a digital storytelling campaign for SGM survivors and campaigners and tell stories to help improve healthcare services, highlight the importance of working directly with the people who are affected and include the quality of patient care for people who'd suffered from FGM and hopefully prevent it in the future. So that's policymakers. The next one, it gets quite technical, but bear with me on this one. So the next one is payers. So if you think about pharmaceutical products, in most cases, not all cases, especially in America, sorry, the patient isn't directly paying the pharmaceutical company for a drug. Usually what happens is there's someone in between who is choosing to pay the pharmaceutical company for a drug and give it to the patients under their care. So, for example, in a lot of Europe, it will be a national health service. So they will be paying for the drugs and offering it to the patients for free, the ones that have been approved. In the US, it's more likely to be a private health insurer. So obviously you do pay the private health insurer and there might be a copay, but essentially they are paying the bulk of the price for the drug. And if you imagine they have an allocated budget, but they have all the pharmaceutical products ever that have been approved available to them, they have to choose with the money that they have which products to use. So it's almost like going to a supermarket, but me giving you only 30 pounds, dollars, euros, whichever currency you like to use. You can't just provide, you can't just buy everything with that $30. You have a set amount. So you have to choose what is best for you and what is best for the patients. So to decide what's best for the patients, obviously you need to understand what the patients are going through and what's best for their quality of life. So again, I won't read this all out to you, but there are kind of two steps. So the first one is regulatory agencies. So you might have heard of the EMA, or which is Europe, or the FDA for the US. And what they do is they decide, is that drug actually safe and effective, and should and can patients take it? So when they say yes, that drug is available for patients to take in a way, or they've said that patients can take this safely and it will help them improve their health. But unfortunately, it's not that simple. So you might have heard previously of a drug being approved by the FDA, for example, in the USA, but you can get it under one insurance company and not another. Or likewise, if you're in Europe, it might have been approved by the EMA, but you can get it in the UK, but not in France. And the reason for that is because, going back to the budget. So the people who hold the budget are called health technology assessment in most of the world, but in some places it'll be, like the US, it'll be private insurance companies who hold the budget. So what they will say is, wow, I have a drug for people with breast cancer and a drug for people with NMO, and obviously lots more, but they have to decide which ones they will fund under their budget, and that will change per region, per country, per insurance company, for example. So for them to decide what to pay for, they need to know what the patients want. They need to know if it works, and for that they need patients to try it out in clinical trials, which we've mentioned many times before, but also explain, you know, how will they know, for example, what effect it'll have on how many times a patient might go to the hospital. They need the patients to tell them what life was like before the drug and what life is after, what has changed and how it might save them money, because that's what payers care about. And of course, quality of life as well. So how it affects how you live and also the health of the patients. A quick case study here was, so this was a charity called Duchenne UK, and they helped people with a disease called Duchenne muscular atrophy, which is a rare disease. And of course, when people are measuring which drug is most cost effective, if you measure two different drugs the same way, but one for example, breast cancer and one for a rare disease, then the rare disease will quite often not get paid for because they tend to be more expensive. So what these guys did is they actually produced their own parameters to measure how effective and cost effective a DMD drug was, so that they could provide this to the payers who were deciding whether to pay for it. And it would help them to make a decision, and a decision towards actually paying for it as well, rather than trying to compare it to another disease that was too different. They made a very specific way to measure this and help them make the right decision. So that's payers. The very last one is a nice easy one, because you're all patient ambassadors of some kind. So patient advocacy groups such as the Sumaira Foundation. These are people who, of course, offer support to patient groups. But as we mentioned earlier, you know, patient advocacy groups are now so much more than just a helpline, a community a shoulder to cry on and talk to. They now also do funding research. They lobby for access to new treatments. They lobby for policy change. As we spoke about all these people in the healthcare system, they can have an impact. And they are often also comprised of people who have suffered from a disease themselves. So either they will have it or a close family member will have it. And therefore, they're not only experts, but they are also really passionate about it, which makes them powerful. So how can patient advocacy groups work with patient advocacy groups? So a lot of them can sometimes come together to form a larger group or an alliance or an umbrella organization. So here are some examples here. And that means that they're all working together to fight for a common goal. And because patient advocacy groups can sometimes be a bit small or limited in resource capability, capacity, when they all come together, it allows them to have a louder voice, and it allows them to just do that bit more together, to share what they have to make a bigger change. And of course, this can be in a formal way like these groups here, or maybe it's just you work on a single project with one other group that you know wants to achieve the same thing. And I think this is the last slide we have, but another way that patient groups can work together is by creating what is called a community advisory board. So let's say in a particular country, there are somehow managed to be five different patient groups all trying to help people with NMO. What can happen there is when regulators, industry, academia, doctors want to talk to people with NMO, they can all go to any of these five different groups, and there's a lot of crosswires and probably politics as well. So what can be done then is that representatives from each of those groups can come together and create one community advisory board, so that what they say is consistent, it represents all of the groups, not just one of them. It's a bit more neutral, and it's also time saving, because you don't have to talk to five different groups and each group have to talk to five different stakeholders. You can do it together. So that's another way that patient groups can work together. And you might be happy to know that that's the last slide I have to talk to you. And the next thing we have is any questions?
Wow, that was so, what a presentation. I feel like I learned so much. Thank you so much for presenting. And of course that video was so powerful, but very, very rich information for all of us, regardless of where in the world we are or what disease that we advocate for. So thank you, Ankita and Caitlin. Really lovely, lovely, lovely presentation. Does anybody have any questions for Ankita and Caitlin? If you do, please feel free to populate questions in the chat or the Q&A function. If you would like to come on video and ask a question, you're most welcome to do that too. Just let me know. So we'll give everyone a few minutes. And if you don't have any questions, that's okay. That must mean that Caitlin and Ankita covered everything.
Oh, we thoroughly confused everyone.
Or Sumaira, it would be also nice to hear from people what they have done, maybe an example of something that we have shared, because that will help others learn from them.
Absolutely. Do we have any brave people in the audience who would like to share? I see some TSF people. Would be nice to hear from you guys, but we'll give you a second. But in the meantime, great presentation. Very, very inspiring. I already have so many ideas now after listening to your presentation. By the way, who made that video?
So that's a trailer of a movie called How to Survive the Plague. And wow, there are actually several books also on the same topic on this group, patient advocacy group. It was called ACT UP, AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power. So this was the first kind of documented patient advocacy group activity at this scale.
Wow.
So there are books and movies on that, but this is the most kind of most popular movie. It's called How to Survive the Plague. And this was just a trailer of that.
Oh, wow. Chilling. Oh, actually, you know what I think would be helpful? It would be nice to maybe hear from you all. What is VMLY&R Health and your specific division, the patient partnerships? What do you guys do?
So we are, we specialize in health communication. So we enable our pharmaceutical clients and the patient advocacy groups, hospitals, specialists, all to get a good understanding of a treatment. So we create communications for a variety of stakeholders, and we created the patient partnership program because we thought we are missing a trick there if you're just talking to hospitals and healthcare systems, because a lot of our people in our group are scientists and have PhDs and are have advanced degrees in science, and we thought it's all about science. Where is the human context of disease? And that's why from that thought, the patient partnership program emerged. And I must tell you that 3 years, Caitlin and I have been listening to patient stories after patient stories. And in spite of being a doctor, I felt I learned more in these chats, in these conversations, than what I would have read in a textbook. Because the human context of disease is one, the true authentic description of a disease. What you see in textbooks and what is taught in medical schools is just so clinical. It loses the human side of what actually happens. So, and I'm just, we both, Caitlin and I, and a lot of people who listen to the patient talks that we have every month from people, experts, patient experts from across the globe, across diseases, it is just fascinating to see what they have achieved.
Yeah.
And for you as well, Sumaira, your story has been so inspiring. A lot of people after your talk actually wrote messages and have told us how they have been touched by what a patient can do. And that was also the essence of the ACT UP story, where FDA said, oh, we don't talk to normal people. We don't talk to patients because they don't have any scientific background, right? So that was the belief system. And to a large extent, even today in a lot of people which form the healthcare ecosystem, this belief set still exists. So it is for the patients to show them the real picture and to make change.
Absolutely.
You know, because I always say, for a researcher, it is a research project. For a doctor, it is a disease that has to be treated. For the patient suffering or their child suffering, it can't be more personal than that.
Totally. Totally. And everything you said just, I mean, completely resonates. I think from where I stand, as I, you know, a patient myself, and I would say a patient leader, it's become a personal mission for me to, you know, relay this message to our community, our patients and our caregiver community, that you're so much more than your illness. You know, just because you get sick doesn't mean somehow you're incapable of doing anything. And furthermore, we can transform our lived experiences into real change and impact for others. And I want all patients, regardless of what you have, to know and truly believe this, because, you know, I think TSF is a living example of that. You know, we came together as patients and said, how do we do this? How do we make change? And of course, there's a lot more that we have to do. But when I think about the last 8 years of TSF and me living with this illness, I mean, I'm just in complete awe of this community. We really banded together. And everybody has unique skill sets that complement the other. And it's, you're absolutely right. There is so much that we can achieve. And I would say in the setting of, you know, rare disease, our input and our stories and our experiences can shape the future of these illnesses. So I feel very inspired. Thank you so much. This was incredible.
Mm. I think I will take this opportunity to tell you about what Caitlin recently did.
Oh, let's hear it.
Caitlin, why don't you tell us how a simple one line can make a change in understanding of a disease? I mean, it was very special and it was very powerful what Caitlin did.
She didn't warn me she was going to embarrass me, by the way. So I'm a patient myself. I have a rare disease called cystic fibrosis.
You do?
I do, yes, surprise.
God, I didn't know that.
You're all patients, right, Sumaira?
Yeah. So hence why, of course, the work that we do is important to me. So I know firsthand how the perspective is different, right?
Wow.
And so I entered a sort of competition type thing to actually, I've got it on my desk here, to create this campaign. And I presented it to the Cystic Fibrosis Trust in the UK. And it's about CF, and it's about, I mean, we were asked to come up with a creative campaign that sort of was something we were passionate about, that we knew about. And as a rare disease patient, you're always the biggest expert in that disease, of course. So I came up with this campaign called, can you see? Oh, I'm all blurred, hang on.
Yeah, you gotta unblur it. I wanna see though.
Virtual background, none. Okay,
yeah, so there you go.
This is the campaign. We were coughing before it went viral.
Oh, I love that.
So obviously it's relating it to kind of the stigma around coughing because of the whole COVID-19 pandemic, and cough, relating it to the sort of universal experience everyone had of the pandemic of being stigmatized for having a cough. There are lots more parallels as well. And one of the other pieces was that we have always had to social distance, because one of the things that a lot of people don't know is people with CF can't meet each other, mm-hmm. because they carry germs that are dangerous to not everyone, but just to other people with CF.
Yeah.
It's very isolating. And actually, we spoke to a focus group of other people with CF, and they could make so many different connections between what everyone had gone through in the pandemic and CF. And I think it gave people, it made it sort of relatable, right? No one will ever understand what living with a rare disease is like. But by sort of comparing it to what other people can relate to and saying, this is actually what I live with. Because I think, like Ankita mentioned, you can read in a textbook that two people with CF can't meet each other. But when you think about it, there's no, when you're in a community like this, so for example, your NMO community, isn't it so nice to have other people who actually understand you? Absolutely. Whereas with CF, we can't meet each other. We can do Zooms and everything, but you know, they hold big fundraising events and galas, much like yours, and people with CF aren't actually allowed to attend it because they can't meet each other. And that's something that you just necessarily get from a textbook. So, and the stigma as well, and the worry to pick up any kind of respiratory infection has always been there for people with CF pre-pandemic.
Right.
So that was the idea behind it. And hopefully it's, you know, brought that to life for a lot of people. It was run in the UK on sort of billboards and on social media, wow. as well. So hopefully it's helped raise that understanding. And there's going to be some polling going on later in the year to sort of see if it changed the needle.
Caitlin, that is amazing. First of all, what a creative slogan. It's brilliant, actually. It's so smart, so witty, so relevant. Just wow, I'm so moved. Wow. You won.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, it became a real thing, so yes.
It's everywhere. It's on billboards, it's everywhere. She's famous.
Oh my god.
She was on BBC, on a what? BBC program being interviewed, yeah.
Oh, please share that with us. You know, by the way, you know, just because we have NMO and MOG doesn't mean we can't, you know, support each other. Whatever, send us whatever you have. I would love to share it with our people. That is incredible. What an achievement. Good for you. I can't wait to hug you. Oh,
well, see you soon.
What a great story. Well, listen, guys. Thank you so much for being here, for taking the time to educate our community. And like, you know, Caitlin, I always, you know, liked the both of you, of course. I very much enjoy working with you, learning from you both, but I definitely now feel a heightened bond with you, because I actually didn't realize that you had a rare disease. And you can be sure that you have my full support. And we're so happy to be connected to the both of you.
Great.
Well, we'll see each other in London soon. So thank you.
Right. Just one last thing, Sumaira, for everyone who is on the call, is please feel free to share our email IDs. Very happy to help, support, answer questions, or maybe just have a chat, whatever. We are here to support.
Absolutely. This is Beyond a wonderful the group. They are based in London, but they are helpful to everyone in the world. So all thank you for joining. This will be available on our video libraries. Ankita and Caitlin, what a pleasure. And thank you for educating us on this.
No worries. And we'll share the slides, which have our emails at the end of, as well, anyway, plus all the links to everything that we talked about today.
Best part of my week so far. Thank you so much for sharing that.
Thank you for having
us. Absolute privilege.
Have a good day. We'll see you soon.
You too. See you.
Bye. Thanks, everyone.